continue in our series, a series that is proving to be a powerful and important conversation, and certainly opportunity to think about the unique ways in how we can hear the voice of God. So if you need a Bible, certainly shoot your hand up. Someone can get a Bible to you. We certainly will have the scripture and things on our screens, so you can also follow along in that way. But I am so blessed that we have the opportunity once again to continue in this series around hearing the voice of God. And I don't know about you, if you're like me, hearing the voice of God is a discipline that in some seasons of my life is easier than others. Amen. Sometimes I can hear God's voice as if God is really communicating very clear. And then other times I'm wondering if God is speaking or even listening at all. And so this series is hopefully an effort that will give us a great opportunity to reflect on the many ways that we know and believe that God will speak to us and is seeking to speak to us in the name of the Lord. So we're turning to the book of Hebrews, chapter number 3. Hebrews chapter number 3 is where we will spend our time today. We are inviting you to join us in this verse. The book of Hebrews is considered to have been a, they had back in the day what they called pseudo-authors, or folks who signed certain letters on behalf of their teacher, on behalf of the person that discipled them, often in a way to help it gain some credibility and some authority. And so the Hebrews is often thought to have been one such letter that is attributed to Paul, but most folks believe that it was one of Paul's disciples, one of Paul's mentees, if you will, who took a collection of important sayings of the early discipleship process and gathered them together in a way to help continue to make a convincing and articulatable description of what it means to follow the ways of Jesus. So we're jumping in of chapter number 3 in the book of Hebrews. Go ahead and read along with us. It should be on the screen. Thank God. Amen. Verse number 7, the scripture says, "Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says today," everybody say today. "Today, if you hear God's voice, do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion, as on the day of testing in the wilderness, where your ancestors put me to the test, though they had seen my works for 40 years. Therefore, I was angry with that generation, and I said, they always go astray in their hearts, and they have not known my ways. As in my anger, I swore they will not enter my rest." Verse number 12, "So take care, brothers and sisters, that none of you may have an evil, unbelieving heart." Woo! Whoa. Just describing it that way makes me not want to have one of those. Amen. "Take care that you do not have an evil, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God. But exhort one another every day." Somebody say every day. "As long as it is called today, so that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. For we have become partners of Christ, if only we hold our first confidence firm to the end." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Let us say thanks be to God. So I want to spend a few moments talking for this continued series on hearing the voice of God, keys to hearing the voice of God. I believe that one of the most important keys is your heart, is our heart. I call it the heart factor. Bow your heads with me and let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus. Thank you for the word of God that has been read for us, the people of God. We ask you to hide these words in our hearts so we will not sin against you. And please send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. Let it rest upon me and even the hearers of this word. In Jesus' name we pray. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. The heart factor. Now, it is so important for us to appreciate that how you and I are constituted, at least from a biblical anthropological point of view, meaning that the scriptures, the whole of scriptures from Judaism all the way through to Christian faith, give us an anthropology, a sense, a description of how we are structured. Not necessarily, I believe, as a point of conflict or to argue with each other, but as a way to help describe how God interacts with us and in reverse, how we are to interact with God. In the Old Testament or the Hebrew scriptures, the Judaism side of the scriptures, you find that the anthropology as described in the scriptures was known as a body spirit. And then when you get over into the Christian New Testament, it is sort of redefined or expanded as a body soul spirit. That on the Hebrew side of the description, if you will, it was commonly thought that we are two parts, the body and the spirit. The body is the flesh, and the spirit is that which God breathed into human beings in the creation narratives of Genesis. And then when you come over into the Christian New Testament side, there is another description that is expanded that talks about us being a body and a spirit, but also adds now the soul. Because in many respects, Jesus and by extension Paul and many of the other disciples started to understand or at least make explicit that your soul is an important part of your composition. That in many respects, your body may be temporal and temporary, and your spirit may be the animating life force that gives your body some movement and gets you that divine connection to God. And your soul is that which will outlast both your body and your spirit. That God, I believe, in God's divine providence and wisdom, particularly through the text, is attempting to help us appreciate that there's more to you than the naked eye. And I know some of y'all look real good today, so that's not a whole lot of, you know, big news. But for folk like me and some few rest of us, I'm so glad there's more to me than what you see. You ought to give your neighbor a high five and tell them there's more to you than what I see. There's more to me than what you see. Amen. Because God understands that in order for me to be in right alignment and communication with God, sometimes God will meet me at different points of my existence. Sometimes God will speak to me through people, through my signs. We talked about last week, visions and dreams, and that will resonate on my physical level. Sometimes will speak to me, God will speak to us and through our spiritual engagement. And sometimes God will speak to us through the matters of our soul, our heart, those things that are not able to be fully handled with our hands, but we know it's real. We know it's real. How many know you don't understand how your heart gets broken, makes you start to feel all under the weather, if you will, but you know it's real. Anybody ever had a broken heart in here today? Amen. Amen. Maybe I was just the only one to have my heart broke until I met Cherise. Amen. And she put it all back together again. That in many respects, you and I are people who have been constituted by God to have a very nuanced and complex composition. And yet, when we talk about our heart, that part of us that actually holds the deepest aspiration and that which, in many respects, pumps lots of life into us. How many of you know the scriptures talk also about our heart can be hardened? And here in the text, we actually see the writer talking about making sure that we do not suffer from a hardened heart. I'm so fascinated by this idea of a hardened heart because for many of us who know folks who have issues with heart disease or heart failure, that there is a physical reality that can create hardened hearts. In a medical sense, this is called atherosclerosis. Hopefully I said that right. That's why I'm a preacher, not a doctor. Amen. But atherosclerosis is a form of hardening arteries in our heart, in our actual valves, that make it difficult, sometimes impossible, for blood to circulate freely because the valves and the arteries become hardened and calcified. They get too brittle and too rigid, and then they start to break. And sometimes they get so clogged that no blood can get through there, and you start to suffer from things like strokes, heart attacks, all because your heart gets hard. And if you read more about what causes atherosclerosis, you find that your diet, possessing or eating too much fatty cholesterol-filled food, will clog up your arteries and cause the blood circulation to get obstructed. Lack of exercise would cause you to have a form of living that I think they call it as sedentary or, yeah, that. Where, because you don't get enough movement, your body will adjust to that kind of stationary living. And the stationariness of your life will create a hardening of your heart. Y'all know I'm about to preach this thing in a second, right? I mean, how many of you know that as it is in the physical, sometimes it can give us a foreshadowing of what is getting ready to happen in the spiritual? That you and I can get so clogged up by life and by challenges. In the scripture, it even names it as sin. That it will cause our heart to harden and we will not be able to hear God's voice. I mean, it is then a powerful challenge for us to make sure that our hearts do not become hardened to God, to one another, and dare I even say, to ourselves. Because if you and I aren't careful, we can begin to have hardened hearts that will translate to violent interactions with those whose hearts have not gotten as hard as ours. I love St. Augustine, a North African church father from the 4th century. He says on this quote, I think we got a slide. It says, "To my God, a heart of flame. To my fellow man or person, a heart of love. and to myself a heart of steel. And if I were to quickly unpack what Augustine is trying to lift up, I think Augustine understands that your heart, our heart, is such an important part of how we will engage with God, with one another, and even ourselves. That Augustine says, I got to make sure my heart stays on fire for God. Because there's a whole lot of folk who like to extinguish my fire for God and put me on fire for their thing and their agenda. My fellow person, a heart of love. That love should be your posture to those outside of you. And that if your heart is not bent in a way towards loving those outside of you, you will be susceptible to a form of hatred and apathy. And then a heart of steel towards yourself. It's not telling you to be cold-hearted to yourself. But it is telling us sometimes that we got to make sure that we don't let our heart lead us in a way that is opposite to the way God would have us interact with God and others around us. See, Augustine understood that sometimes, Augustine, of all the theologians, he was one who, some folks criticized him. He had a deep sense of the depravity of the human heart. Augustine would say things like, there is nothing good in me. That's why I need the Lord. Paraphrase, 21st century. He would pull from these passages that would declare things like Ezekiel chapter number 34, I think verse 29, somewhere around there, that God says, I will put in you a new heart of flesh and remove from you a heart of stone. Oh, you ought to tell your neighbor, you need a heart transplant today. Amen. God's trying to do something. Or he would go to the book of Psalms and he would probably piggyback on top of David, where David says, create in me a clean heart and renew the right spirit within me. Because David knew, particularly in this passage that I just quoted, David just got done killing up some folk to hide his sin. And how many of you know when your heart gets too cluttered, you'll start to hide the very thing that God desires to set you free from? And dare I get too bogged down in the radical individual that I can't speak to the craziness of the systemic and the structural? But how many of you know our country has had a hard heart for many, many years? And now we are seeing the manifestation so clear of a hardened heart that now you have President Trump and his cabinet, Steve Bannon, and these folk passing budgets that will cut preschool, after school programs, arts and PBS, food programs. They got the nerve to stand up and say they're not producing any results. I say, well, that's because they're working. I don't know. If you're hungry and you're eating food, that will probably keep you from starving to death. Amen? Hello, somebody. But when your heart gets so hardened that you can't now see the suffering of your loved one, of your brother, sister, of your concerned person that you're supposed to be concerned with, you will then be seduced into what we see this budget is continuing and now being even more bent to, a budget built on military force. One writer has even said this week that this budget seems to be a budget that is preparing our country for war. And I'm here to tell you that if you are a
elected official, politician, and you are participating in this moment in such a way, if you are a citizen, if you claim to be a follower of Jesus, and you think that of all the limited resources we have, we need more money being put into bombs and airplane weapons and nuclear weapons while folk are starving in our country, starving all over the world. I'm here to tell you that your heart has lost its flesh and it has become a heart of stone. And we ought to be careful. We as a country need to be careful, because if we do not believe that judgment is coming on this country as we become more stone cold hearted, then we are making a mockery of God and of every word that God has spoken. This then is why the church, everybody say the church, followers of Jesus, must continue to proclaim the message of healing, peace, hope, and restoration. We must continue to proclaim loudly that our hearts do not need to become stony. And I got to tell you, it is still a job for us, because these conditions that happen could easily turn our hearts to stone. There's so many things that have happened in our lives that will make our hearts become so hard as stone that we will participate in the destruction of our loved one, of our neighbor. We will stand by and record their destruction rather than imagine helping. We will become desensitized. That's what happens when your heart gets as hard as stone. You become desensitized. You no longer cry over the pain and the misery of others. And I believe when you stop crying over the suffering of your loved ones, you become complicit in their death. When we can be okay with watching our loved ones suffer, our hearts have begun, dare I say, cross the threshold of becoming too stony. And when your heart becomes stony, you're going to have a difficult time hearing God speaking to you about how you should respond. How the folks can read this Bible, and the Bible speaks more about how we should treat the poor, how we should treat the suffering and the marginalized. But when they read those scriptures, they don't resonate. But they can find every scripture about hurting somebody. Find every scripture about wealth and prosperity for the person. But can't find nothing in there about no charity. About no sharing and communal living. It's because our hearts have become so stony that we're reading what we want to hear, rather than hearing God's voice speaking to us, telling us what we need to know. That's why the scripture says, thy word have I hid in my heart. You got to put this word in your heart, so as you're hearing the voice of God speaking to you, whether it's through dreams, through signs, through your prayer, through your worship, through your vocation, that God's voice can resonate with the word of God that you've hid in your heart. Or else you'll start to hear these other voices that will start to resonate in your heart. And you'll think it's the voice of God. Who this thing, man, that's a word. That's a word. That's a confirmation. It's confirmation of the devil. Amen. Because you got yourself so full of the devil. You give your neighbor a high five and tell him, don't be full of the devil. Amen. So how in this text do you and I make sure the heart factor is fully attended to so we can hear the voice of God? The first thing you got to realize is you have to endure testing. Somebody holler, endure the test, endure the test. Verse number 7, it says, do not harden your hearts as on the day of testing in the wilderness. Here, the writer is referring back to the children of Israel when they were in the wilderness on their way to the promised land. Think about that for a second. They're in the wilderness on their way to the promised land. They're in the wilderness on their way to the promised land. They've just left bondage in the wilderness on their way to the promised land, and they get tested. And in the scripture, it's actually described as the mixed congregation or the mixed multitude. That there were some folks who left, listen, this is about to help somebody, who left bondage. Somehow they got swept up in the liberation struggle. They left bondage, and they're on their way to the promised land, but as soon as the test came, they start grumbling. Well, it was kind of better back over here in Egypt when we was getting our heads cracked. At least we knew the cracking was coming. Well, at least I know we were slaves over there, but at least we had, I don't know, 3 square meals a day. We out here, we don't know where our food's gonna come. I mean, I know he the president, but we should at least honor the office. Talking about a mixed congregation. Folk who somehow get caught up in your group that is committed to liberation, to freedom, but they're always trying to get you to go backwards. Anybody know any folk like that? Anybody know anybody? You're trying to figure out, man, I'm trying to be free. I'm trying to get better. You will endure testing when you surround yourself with folk who are committed to the collective freedom of everyone, you, yourself, and everyone. And they are not seduced by a sanitized past that says we're gonna make America great again. Great for who? Man, you should come back out here and we should just hit this corner. You should just, man, forget them classes. Let's, man, you know, you only live once. Man, go, you should get, man, he wasn't that bad, was he? I mean, don't it just suck to be alone, don't it? Come on, call him up. Call her up. That's all right. Sanitized past. You and I have to make sure that during this season of testing, our heart does not get hardened because we are being filled with opinions and thoughts that don't square up with reality. There's a reason why you running out of that hellish situation. I mean, you wasn't jogging, you wasn't skipping, you was running. I wish I had an honest church in here today. He sings a song, says, I'm running for my life. If anybody asks you what's the matter with me, you tell them I'm saved, sanctified, Holy Ghost filled, fire baptized, and I'm running. You ought to give your neighbor a high five and tell him you need all that to be running too. You need to be saved. You need to be sanctified. You need to be Holy Ghost filled. Fire baptized. Why you need that fire? To burn off all that stuff that's trying to keep you connected? If you don't endure the test, listen, your heart will turn hard. Rather than the wilderness experience being an opportunity to tune your ear to the voice of God. The wilderness can be helpful for some of us because in the wilderness, you'll learn to hear a lot more clearly. There's a reason why all the real monastic, spiritual folk from every tradition, whenever they're trying to get a spiritual experience, there's a reason they go to the desert, to the wilderness, because there's too many distractions here in the city. When I used to drive cross country, I used to love to drive, open up my sunroof, and just look at the stars. Because you see everything without distraction. No fog, no skyscrapers, no smog. Just free, unencumbered access. Endure the testing in a way that tunes your ear to the voice of God. So next time you find yourself in a wilderness experience, you ought to be asking yourself, God, what would you have me to learn? How are you speaking to me in this moment? I don't want my heart to become hard because the situation is hard. But I want my heart to stay pure. Jesus said it like this, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. So the question then for you, loved one, how is your heart responding to your season of testing? Is your wilderness experience tuning your heart, Is it tuning your ear to hear God's voice, or is it hardening your heart today? Today, the question, can your heart be a catalyst to tune your ear so you can hear the voice of God? Second thing the scripture lifts up in verse number 10, it says God is starting to get turned up on them because God's realizing, listen, every time I bring you out, you end up falling right back into the same situation. I bring you out, you go back. I bring you out, you go back. I bring you out, you go back. Back forth, back forth. God's like, what's up with that? God says, for 40 years, I brought you out in the wilderness. Made sure you didn't need for nothing. But you keep going back to the situation. How many know some of us can be so addicted to our dysfunction? We can be in a form of relationship with abusive forces. That's why I'm not the most patriotic person in the world. Because this country don't love me. And keep it real, this country don't love you either. The old saints had it right. This world is not my home. I'm just passing through. But while I'm here, God asked me to be a steward. Because this world and all that's created belongs to God. Even I belong to God, so I don't get to write my own job description of what I'm going to do. Well, God, I know what you said, but this is what I'm going to do. And you know what, God? Since I'm going to do what I'm going to do, I expect you to bless what I'm going to do. It don't work like that. God says, you must stay faithful if you're going to hear the voice of God. Verse number 10, God says, they always go astray in their hearts. That the heart, if it is not well ordered, can lead you astray. Ooh, I know somebody in here know what I'm talking about. I know y'all a little quiet because you're a little bothered by this point. But you better stop trusting your heart so much, because that heart is getting you in a whole lot of trouble. I wish I could talk to somebody. You ought to give your neighbor a high five and tell him I got a straying heart. There are all kind of things that a undisciplined heart will have you and I participating in, thinking that it will bring you life, all the while it is destroying that which God has created you to be. Your heart should not be so committed to anything that challenges God's call, God's voice in your life. And that's hard. Lord knows it's hard because my heart is wicked. Even as the preacher, Lord knows, if God don't keep me, y'all gonna be like, man, Pastor Mike. And I'd self, it's still early. Amen. Y'all better pray for your pastor. Matter of fact, you better pray for yourself too. When you call my name, call yours. Ain't it something you could be in a prayer meeting and you have met these holy folk and they hollering, Lord bless the preacher and Lord bless the mother and Lord bless the gossiper and bless the liar and bless the murderer. And then all of a sudden they go, Lord bless the, And you know who they praying for when they groaning, right? They call everybody's name but their own. They can't even form their lips to say, Lord, touch my lying lips. Keep my demonic temper from overflowing. Help me not to slap somebody today and help me not to cuss them out. If you in a prayer meeting and you hear that, you invite me to that prayer meeting because that's some real praying going on. How many know you got to train your heart to not stray away from God's purpose in your life? There's all kinds of things that will make your heart harden so much that you'll stray away. Bitterness, racism, oppression, abuse. Make your heart get hard. Well, God, you're not moving fast enough. So I need to work this thing out on my own. They got one more time, God. Now, listen, God, if you are real, you ought to stop them right there. This is your test, God. God's like, well, my realness ain't based on your weakness. Hello, somebody. God says that he won't put more on you than you're able to bear, but with every burden will give you a way of escape. So you can bear it. That's 1 Corinthians 13, it's 10, 13, something like that. You ought to read it, memorize it, write it down, take a picture. Do something to remind yourself that if you are handling a burden and God has not relieved it from you, it don't mean there's not a way of escape. Now that's a hard word for all of us, for me. I'm trying to figure out, Lord, what is the way of escape for this situation our country and our world got ourselves into? Because I'm worried. I wake up every day and say, Lord, just keep us. Keep me near the cross. I mean praying for those who don't believe in the cross. Lord, keep us all as a people that our hearts do not go astray and we get seduced into responding to evil with evil. With violence, hatred with hatred. You may feel like it is right for you to do so. But when you start responding to the negativity of your life with more negativity, listen, you have immediately jumped out of God's transportation and you walking down the street hitchhiking. Anybody ever met some folks like that? They just walking, looking for a ride. Don't know who they're going to jump in the car with. The car could even be going in a similar direction. But it is up to chance that this person you get in the car with is going to help you get to your destination rather than staying on course with the God who created you, the God who saved you, and the God who sustained you. That's why we as a generation, millennials, we can't get so brand new that we think we can make this journey without the God of our ancestors. I know sometimes you look at this church and you look at these preachers and you look at these church folk and they all make you feel like, Lord, I can do better. There's got to be a better train than this one. But I want to encourage you, stay in the ship of the ancestors, the God of the ancestors that brought us here. Because we ain't lived long enough to know. I mean, I know we smart, but we not old. How many know you can be smart and still not be wise? A lot of book knowledge. Ooh, you so smart. But the wisdom thing, I don't know. Wisdom comes with age, with living a little while. So I always tell the young folk, just keep living. If you live long enough, you will outgrow this foolishness. But the trick of the devil is to get you while you're young. The devil can take you out of here while you're 19, 20, 21, 22, 23. Then the only life you've known is a life of foolishness. But when you get old enough to realize, why am I playing cops and robbers and I'm 30 years old? I'm tired. I can't jump the fence like I used to. I can't dodge bullets like I used to. Why I keep going back to these dysfunctional relationships? I'm too old to be playing games. Lord, help my heart to not go astray. Because if your heart goes astray, I'm going to preach on this maybe on Easter, you'll find yourself in a sunken place. But y'all got to wait till Resurrection Sunday for that one. Amen. What is threatening? Here's the question. Then we're going to wrap up. What is threatening your heart's faithfulness to God, to the voice of God? Is it bitterness? Is it dissatisfaction? Is it disappointment? Is it turning you into a drifter, a wanderer in your faith? You hitchhiking? Trying to get on another ride rather than the one that brought you? Stay faithful. Don't be like the children of Israel. Soon as it gets difficult, let's go back. Got to go back. I know it was hard, but at least, no. Keep moving forward. Stay faithful to God's voice that is trying to propel you forward. Then the final thing we'll say, remain confident. Somebody say, remain confident. Verse number 20. If only we hold our first confidence firm to the end. The greatest tool of evil, both systemic, structural, spiritual, is to cause you to lose your confidence, to make you throw in the towel too soon. Systemic evil, structural evil in our governments, in our bureaucracies, they are successful at grinding us to dust by just moving so slow that you just give out in exhaustion. And on the course to giving out, you start entertaining other voices because it brings doubt. This is taking too long. Why is this taking so long, God? I know what I was told, that you can do anything but fail. Why am I failing? I know that your scripture says that you are God of justice. Why ain't no justice? I know that you say you will mend my broken heart, but why is my heart still broken in a million pieces? I know the word says that you will keep them in perfect peace whose mind is stayed, but why is my mind so troubled? And as you begin to question and understand, God's not threatened by your questions. So you should keep questioning God, but tell your neighbor you have some limits. You have some limits. Your questioning cannot produce a lack of confidence in the God who has the power to do exceedingly and abundantly above all you can ask or think. You must remain confident that the same God who brought you out last time, who brought your mom and them out a time before, the same God who caught you when you were in a free fall and you knew that it was nobody but God, the same God who continues to give you indications that this is not meant for your death, but it's meant for some glory to be had. It's meant so God's glory could shine. You must remain confident of this one thing, as the scripture says, that the one who started this work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. And I'm here to tell you that God's got some work that God is not through with yet. And you got to remain confident that God is going to finish what God started. You ought to give yourself a pat on the chest and say, he's going to finish in me what he started. I'm here to tell you that if you can remain confident, even against all the odds, God will find a way to give you a second burst of wind and energy and faith that will carry you through your darkest time and your darkest moments. I believe, just like the scripture says, that God will always lift up a standard and a defense against the enemy for those who remain faithful and for those who remain confident that God will come through every time. That's why the word says, wait on the Lord and be of good courage. Because if you wait on the Lord, he will give you the wings like an eagle. You may run, but you won't get weary. You will walk, but you won't faint. God will show up right on time. Do I have anybody that believes that God will show up, that God will work it out, that God will sustain you? I know you're struggling, and I know you're crying, and I know your faith may be teetering, but you ought to stand firm on what God has said. And if God says, I will deliver you, then you wait on the deliverance. If God says, I will heal you, then you stand on your healing. If God says, I'll bring your children home, then you wait until your kids come running through the door. If God says justice and peace and mercy are the legacy of the people of God, then I'm going to keep fighting, and I'm going to keep resisting, and I'm going to keep reaching for the God who can. And the God who will. Keep your heart confident. Don't trust in chariots. Don't trust in your forces, your powers. But trust in the God that brought you. And your heart. Come on, stand with me, everyone. Your heart. Your heart will be positioned and soft so you can hear the voice of God. Come on, grab the hand of someone right next to you if you don't.